true paranormal stories that will keep you awake at night. Redditor 31, my first apartment after college was the upper half of an old house. My new roommate had just recently graduated, so he was in no rush to move in. I'd been living with my parents for the past year or so and needed out as soon as possible, so I brought a sleeping bag over with my last load of stuff on day one. No utilities, just camping out by myself in the living room. At some point during the night, I had a vivid dream that a killer with a knife was coming down the main hall toward the door to the living room. Just as he was about to open the door, I woke up terrified. Shook it off, went back to sleep. I was talking to my roommate one morning a few months later. He told me about a weird dream he had the previous night. Seems he had fallen asleep in the living room for the first time and had a dream that killer with a knife was coming down the main hall toward the door to the living room. Just as the killer was about to open the door, my friend woke up. He spent the rest of the night in his own room. I told him about my dream from the first night. We both thought it was weird. Couple months later, a friend needed a place to crash, asked to stay on the couch for a night. Next morning, he mentions he had an odd dream. Killer with a knife was coming down the main hall toward the door to the living room? I asked. Just as he was about to open the door, you woke up? Added my roommate. Look of pure terror on our friend's face is astounding. Redditor 32, I worked in a really old movie theater for my first job. It was a small theater, 6 screens, and all in a line so you could see from one end of the building to the other essentially. Eventually I got promoted to manager, so I had to start the movies. We had film still, so it was a fairly complicated process of threading the projectors and then watching over them because they duck up easily. We always joked about ghosts. Load of weird shit happened around there, like things falling over, doors shutting, and hearing voices. Well, one day I was there with like one employee, slow midweekday, and I walked out of the office up in the projection booth and out of habit looked both ways, you know, the old left right left. To my right there was a woman in a whitish dress and brown hair about 4 feet away just standing there. I only caught a glimpse before doing a double take and she was gone. I wasn't the only person to see her. Several other employees claim they've seen a similar woman around the theater, but I never saw her again, so I'm not sure if I just imagined seeing a person or if I did. Stupid ghosts. Redditor 33, I'm a totally materialistic person and have never experienced anything paranormal in my life. Except one thing that I can't explain. When I was a kid, I had a huge wart on my foot. My parents took me to hospital and doctors tried to burn it out or something, but it didn't work and the wart came back even bigger. Then summer came and I went to my granny to a small Russian village. She saw my wart and called for a woman known as a local healer. She took a thread and started making knots over the wart, whispering something to herself. And in just a week the wart was gone. I learned that this is a traditional and renowned way for healing warts in remote places in Russia, but I have zero explanation how it's possible. Redditor 34, not really paranormal, but it's very difficult for me to tell if my memories are real or not. Redditor 35, recently, a step on the side of my house has a child footprint indented in it. The step is at least 60 years old and now way soft enough to cause a footprint. It 100% was not there before, as I have washed stairs many times. Cannot explain the phantom footprint. Redditor 36, my brother reminded me of this the other day. When we were growing up, we were best friends with a brother and sister pair who were our exact ages, so we spent all our time with them and at their house. Their house was big, it even had a movie theater in the basement. My brother and I slept over often, and the four of us usually slept in the basement in the theater since it had a huge sunken couch that fit all of us. Around the time I was about 9 or so, and brother was older so he remembers it better, our friends were really excited to have us over because they had gotten a few couch cushions in the crawl room so it would be like camping. Brother and I both had no idea what they meant. We knew every inch of their house, so we went to see this room. In their basement around the corner from the theater there was a short door, so short that we had to crawl through to get in. Brother and I had never seen this door before, even though we had practically grown up in this house. We questioned it, but neither of us remember the answer they gave other than they just found it. They were rich, so I guess we assumed it was new construction? Anyway, we slept on couch cushions in that short room that night, and neither my brother or I can remember anything remarkable about it, and we slept in the theater again after that night. The remarkable thing happened a few years later. It was my friend's 14th or so birthday, and I was keeping her busy while her brother was hiding her present, presumably in the crawl room. At the end of her birthday party, he brought up the crawl room. He said something like, "You remember going in and out of there a few times, right?" I said yes. He looked confused and asked me to show him where I remember the door being. We go into the basement and lo and behold, there is no door. Not even an outline where it would have been sealed. My brother kicks the wall and it's solid, cement. We ask our friend's parents and they have no idea, they've never done construction down there and there is no room other than the theater in the basement. Reddit, I was in this room in the basement. All night, we sat on cushions in there and brought a small TV with Nintendo, we went in and out for a solid night. We all remember it. After our friends moved, the new neighbors had us over and my brother and I went in the basement with fresh eyes of logical adults, still nothing. No door, and we realized that there would have been virtually no room for us to sit comfortably because the basement only extends about 4 feet past the edge of the house, the room would have been under our friend's lawn. I know it's not outright scary, but I think it falls in the category of paranormal because it's just baffling. Redditor 37, my grandma's house is chock full of weird stories, going way back. Pretty much everything weird and scary has happened in the hallway leading to the spare bedroom. My grandma would see my grandpa's silhouette walking down the hall. He'd stop at the door to their bedroom and peer in, and she'd ask if he needed something. He wouldn't answer and would keep walking. Peeved, she would get up to go ask him again, only to find him in the living room sleeping, or watching TV and insisting he'd been there the whole time. My mom has heard someone calling her name from the same hall, and once we were there alone house sitting while my grandparents were out of town. They were due back late that night, and my mom and I both heard heavy footsteps coming from the hall. She told me they must have come home early, so she went to greet them. No one there. Guest room at the end of the same hall has a TV that will turn on by itself. They also had a couple stay there, and neither one was particularly superstitious. The next morning the husband was unusually quiet. He finally got a chance to talk to my grandma alone and said very simply someone was watching us last night. He had seen a figure standing in the corner of the room staring at them, and had been so frightened that he just closed his eyes and tried to go back to sleep. When my grandma pressed for details, he kind of shrugged it off and didn't want to talk about it anymore. There's also a middle bedroom between the spare room and my grandparents' room, which we have always just called Tipsy Danger's room because I used to stay with them so often. I was on my bed once when I heard a thump and then a skittering noise, like something had jumped off the bed and was running across the floor. I thought it was the cat being weird, so I sat up to see what she was doing, only to find that the cat was at the foot of the bed staring intently at the doorway to the hall. I looked around for a bit but was unable to find anything. TL, Dr. Grandma's house is super haunted by shadow people. Edit, homophones are confusing. Redditor 38, when I was much younger, I was sitting with my cousin in our grandparents' kitchen talking when I saw a white cat walk from the basement into the bathroom. My cousin, who'd been spinning around in her swivel chair, turned back to face me, absolutely shocked.
"Did you see that? The cat?"
"Yeah." We got up and checked the bathroom but there was nothing there. The basement door had been closed and latched the whole time. I always try to think of an explanation but I can't. Redditor 39, back in my late teens I was teaching myself to read tarot cards, so I would do free readings for friends and family all the time for the practice. So I'm at a family barbecue at my BF's house, and we're all hanging out and chilling when they asked me to get my cards. So I do a fairly boring reading for my BF's mom, and my BF's sister-in-law decides she wants to be next. So I shift over to be across the table from her and set her to shuffling the cards. I throw the cards in standard Celtic cross layout, darkest spread I've ever seen in my life. Almost all major arcana cards, all showing their more negative aspects. So I'm sitting there looking at these cards that are basically saying this person is not good, and my brain is going a mile a minute trying to figure out what the heck I'm looking at. Deep, wolfish, male voice I've never heard before or since says right into my right ear, "Tell her nothing." Not threatening, just giving very clear instruction. I told her I couldn't tell her anything, gathered up the cards and got out of there like my butt was on fire. A few weeks later I'm over there again and it came up I've never told them about the voice. Turns out she's had two palmists and three astrologers react the same way to divination requests. Redditor 40, I've told this story before but it has always been buried in previous threads. I'll tell it again and type it out so as to earn my points the good honest way rather than with cut and pasting. It's long, but I wager worth a read. Several years ago when I was in my mid-20s I accepted a job as visitor services manager at a medium-sized historic house museum. The house was a Victorian Gothic cottage of an author who wrote a single rather important book and then rode that fame from many more less successful and equally poor written publications on various topics. Anyway, the house was beautiful but dark and oppressive in that perfectly creepy manner that only Victorian homes can be. It sat near the street with two other buildings, a carriage house and another mansion behind, all belonged to my non-profit employer. My office was tucked in the front corner of the ground floor of the carriage house. In the daytime it was filled with sunlight and faced the perfectly manicured cottage gardens. But at night it was dark and gloomy and the position of the desk put my back towards the expanse of the quiet empty 100-some-year-old building. It was eerie on the best of days and terrifying on several of the worst, and this dreary March day happened to be the very worst. It had been an exceptionally boring day, as most were, working at an ill-attended museum. All told, I think we'd sent a total of one tour with one visitor and their disinterested college student tour guide through the house. I'd spent most of the day staring longingly at Googled pictures of Robert Pattinson on the computer behind the front desk. As I said, this was a while ago. My tastes have improved. It was before the clock spring forward for the season, so it was nearing dark before closing in, and a deep cloud cover and persistent drizzle didn't improve the ambient lighting. Seated at the front desk in the poorly stocked gift shop, I sent my two remaining tour guides in to close the house for the night, which involved switching off lights, switching others on, shutting some doors, and opening yet others, apparently all to ensure the house burned in a particular manner where that a blaze took it in the night. Or to set up some specifically encouraged path for robbers who managed to ninja sneak past the security system to steal tired velvet upholstered settees and ugly faded lithographs. So the two tour guides were in the house and I was stationed at the front desk, on the main floor of the 1872 carriage house. Directly above me was a lofty attic space used as merchandise and junk storage of the type only museums seem to accumulate, because everyone should save the posters from the 1994 mother-daughter tea fundraiser, just in case. Above me and to the right was the guide break room, complete with crappy folding table and chairs, microwave and multiple boxes and crates of books, educational material, and related. Downstairs in the gift shop, on my desk was an old handset landline phone that could dial out but could also, with the press of an aptly labeled guide room button, reach the room above on speakerphone, so that I might call up and announce a pending tour, or yell at them, or sing, though I don't think I ever did sing to the guides up there. I was just finishing up considering what color Robert Pattinson's I might be in candlelight when I started to hear the most considerable racket coming from the guide break room. It sounded very much like a person of considerable girth lifting heavy objects, carrying them to the other side of the room, and then unceremoniously dumping them out, stomping the entire time. This continued for perhaps 30 seconds, and I recall the thought that drifted up through my confusion and irritation was that sounds urgent, as if the person was doing whatever it was they were doing as fast as possible. Anyway, I was pissed, and no one should have been up there. I called up, on speakerphone, and said something like, "What the heck are you doing?" And no one answered, so I went with the classic fallback of "Hello? Hello? Hello? Hecko?" And then my voice died in my throat as I listened. I could hear him hear it moving clearly through the speakerphone, picking things up, shoving things, dropping things, then I heard it come up to the desk where the phone sat. I could hear it breathing, breathing hard and moving things on the desk, papers, maybe even the phone base. It was at that moment that I realized that not only had I seen both my tour guides leave to close the adjacent house, confirming that I was indeed alone in the building, but that I could see all unlocked doors from my seat, and no one had come in since their departure. The hair stood up on my arms and I immediately radioed our aged by well-meaning security guard who happened to be standing just outside the front door of the carriage house in the misty yuckness of the evening. God knows why he wasn't inside where it was much warmer. He went straight up the stairs upon my call. I watched him march up the first set of stairs and then listened as he turned at the landing and walked up the last handful tentatively. I held my breath waiting for him to open the door and then heard no more sounds. Rod? What's up there? Rod WHO's up there, but there was no one. He came back down the stairs looking at me a bit owlishly as I had insisted there was someone up there. The room had been empty and nothing had been touched, save a pile of freshly crumpled paper in the center of the table. At this point my guides, having heard the ruckus on the radio, returned from closing the house. They swore up and down that when they left nothing had been amiss, that they had not crumpled the paper. There had been a stack of neat new paper on the center of the table when they'd gone to close up. I won't lie. I was shaken by it. I grew up in old houses and have worked in the historical field my entire adult life, so I've encountered a few odd and inexplicable things over the years. But this was much scarier. After we'd finished closing up the visitor center for the day, I knew I would be returning to an empty house and that thought was too much to bear. I instead sat in the parking lot of the local grocery store until my husband finished work. I have no idea what I heard up in that room, who walked up to the phone and was so frantically moving unseen objects, but I know with absolute certainty that it was not good and that is was angry. The oral history that had passed down from guide to guide for generations of museum employees spoke of a young man, a stable hand, who had hanged himself in the building at the end of 19th century. But most museums have a story like that, and it's likely not true. Whatever this was, I sincerely hope I don't meet it again. Edit, every spacing issue ever. Redditor 41, my sister and I go on road trips every year and try to stay in haunted locations. Most places don't seem to be haunted at all, but there are two places that had some weird stuff happen. One Garden House BB in Hannibal, Missouri. I take a journal with me and write a summary of each day right before I go to sleep. Apparently sometime in the night early morning, I wrote a paragraph about having terrible nightmares and that I think something was in our room. I do not remember writing this at all. Two Prospect Places, Trinway, Ohio. My sister and I are the only people there in this big, old house. I went to sleep, but my sister stayed up a little longer. Sometime after midnight my sister is standing next to my bed, nearly incoherent, frantically whispering that she heard someone throw a marble outside the bedroom door. I was either too tired or too scared, likely a combination of both, to go and check. We left as soon as the sun came up that morning. Redditor 42, 8-year-old me lying wide awake in bed. It's after midnight. The rest of the family are already sleeping in their rooms. Suddenly I'm hearing what sounds like every window downstairs is being binged on, and that every pot and pan in the kitchen are being thrown around and binged on each other like someone playing the cymbals would do. I also experienced what I strongly believe what is called a residual haunting. An event that happened in real life that is played over and over again like a recording long after the event in real life has passed. Again, I'm wide awake sometime after midnight. I am a night owl. My bedroom window is open, so I heard things clearly. Heard a car coming up the road. Heard it stop. Then I hear a door opening and the voice of a little girl say, "Bye, Daddy," in a cheerful, "see you later" tone. Car door slams shut and the car immediately peels out like it couldn't wait to go. Tires are screeching. Not 2 seconds later, I hear that little girl scream. It was the most horrific scream I've ever personally heard, even to this day. Of course, I was on my feet and looking out my window to see what the duck was happening. Guess what I saw? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. All is quiet now. Dead quiet. There is no way that little girl could have hidden in the time it took for me to get to my window. There wasn't even anywhere for her to hide in or behind of. My house stood on a hill. The house across the street stood on a hill. There were no bushes she could hide in, as I lived in a place of deserts and canyons. Plus, it was dry as shit out there. Any small movement would have been heard. Redditor 43, you guys know what shadow people are, right? The name kind of gives it away. They're shadows and also people, look like a silhouette, you get the idea. Anyway, this was back when I was maybe 10 or 11 years old. I'm over at a friend's place and we go out back in the forest behind his house. We walking through some tall brush, when out of the corner of my eye, I see what looks like the silhouette of a head and shoulders rise over the brush. I ignore it, thinking I was just seeing things. A short while later, we're out on a wide trail, when something darts across the path in front of us. It looked like the silhouette of a man hunched over, running from one side to the other, somehow leaving the plants on either side were perfectly intact. My friend turns to me and goes, "Holy shit, did you see that?" I did, and we got out of that forest as fast as we could. We sat in his house, terrified, and I mentioned the head and shoulders I initially saw. Turns out he saw them too, and just ignored them like I did. What we saw still freaks me out to this day, nearly 10 years later, because we never really knew what we saw. Redditor 44 posted this before but got buried. "Creepiest thing I've experienced was when I saw a ghost." I put it in quotations because there very well could be a rational explanation for what I thought I experienced, but nevertheless it was still really creepy. About 2 years ago, my friends and I visited Letchworth Village, in Rockland County, New York. It was a psychiatric hospital for the mentally and physically disabled, opened in 1911 and was the site of the first polio vaccine trials in the United States. Letchworth was finally shut down in the 90s because of the rampant abuse and mistreatment of the live inpatients there, but many of the hospital's abandoned buildings are still standing on the campus, and most are decayed enough, or already broken into, to be able to easily climb in. The final building we explored was once the main hospital, I believe. My friend mentioned that this place was apparently featured on some Ghost Hunters type show as one of the most haunted places in America or something, and so we were pretty excited when we saw someone had graffitied on the wall, "The ghosts are here." The first room had rusted metal bars suspended by wires hanging from the ceiling. This in itself was not out of the ordinary, but as we entered, a gust of wind shook the bars, which began to swing and clank eerily against each other. Needless to say, it was a nice spooky entrance. Upon exiting that tetanus trap, we entered a long hallway with a big staircase leading to the basement and the second floor. Ignoring every single horror film-infused instinct to not go down the flight of foreboding stairs into what could be the very gates of hell, we climbed down to the basement, which was, of course, extremely dark, save for a welcoming burst of light streaming in from a broken window near the stairs. With our flashlights on, we made our way slowly through the basement hall, and at about halfway we found the old morgue. One of my photographer friends set up his tripod and began taking a long exposure of the morgue as the rest of us waited and jokingly tried to convince him to climb inside of it. As this was taking place, I happened to look back down the hall from where we came. I couldn't make out any details of the hallway, except for the beam of light at the other end. It looked as if there was something partially blocking the beam of light coming in from the broken window. Kind of like a shadow, but more like a silhouette where a person's upper torso and head would have been illuminated by the light, instead of just darkness. However, the second I noticed it, it fucking moved and the beam of light was undisturbed once again. Right around that time my fight or flight instinct kicked in, and my bowels went a little loose as the sound of footsteps came clearly from behind the doors of the unexplored room ahead of us. I can't remember if I screamed or cried, probably a little of both, but we left pretty quickly after that. Bonus, on a lighter note, one of the rooms in the haunted hospital was covered in legendary insults which made us all giggle. Personal favorite, smegma tits. Redditor 45, my freshman year of college I bought a Ouija board. I had had one through high school and always had really awesome experiences with it. I went down to the woods with three of my friends and we started. 15 minutes into, shit was getting scary and none of our phone were working. The dial was darting across the board and one of the guys I was with started recording with his phone. A minute after he started recording, the board flew up with no intervention of any of us about 4 feet in the air and slammed down. I burst out in tears, ran towards the school and all my friends followed. I was handed the board and someone else had the box. I went to go put the board in the box and it was yanked out of my hands by whatever spirit girl we were talking to. No one has ever believed that story besides the people I was with. I don't really care, because I know that it happened. I haven't touched a board since and never will. Redditor 46, currently in my house, things like my couch moves when there is no one there. I hear doors closing and when I check there is no one there. Sometimes I wake up with scratches on my forearms, but the scariest is this feeling I have. It is like a cold, angry feeling that comes out of nowhere and overwhelms. This has been going on for the last 2 weeks and I am losing sleep over it. Redditor 47, my wonderful wife worked in assisted living homes for many years. She became very close to her residents and was somehow connected to many of them. One Friday evening we were at a restaurant having our date night dinner. She suddenly straightened up, put her hand to her throat, and said, "Oh no. John. No." I asked her what was wrong. "John just died." And then, a moment later, she said, "Something's wrong. Oh no. No, don't do that, let him go." I wrote down the time, consoled her, and we went home. She called work. John had died at exactly the time she reacted. 10 miles away. And then they had to perform CPR because he did not have a DNR order on file. And brought him back, breaking his sternum as usual. He finally died in my wife's arms 2 days later. I had always wondered about my wife's psychic abilities. I had learned through the years to not question them. But this was the first time I had ever gotten solid proof. She's a special lady, and I'm very lucky to be married to her, for 32 years so far. Redditor 48, one night before I had this rough dream where my friend came up to me hysterical about his dad being gone and was having a terrible time. It was one of those dreams that looked felt real, but the moment you wake up you realize it wasn't true. Flash forward a couple hours later, I was sitting next to the kid who I dreamed about like we always did before going out to football practice in the 105 degree heat. And for some reason I turned to help and told him all about the dream and described it thoroughly to him. And all he did, with a stone cold face, said that today is the day my dad left my family 10 years ago. And up until that point I never knew anything about his father or when he left his family. Redditor 49, wasn't going to post about this because it makes it that much more real, but it's probably for the best instead of trying to deny it. When I was a young child, me and my family moved around a lot, Coast Guard. We always drove, so we stayed in a lot of hotels. Practically every time I stayed in a hotel, after my family had fallen asleep, I would see a creature moving back and forth between the walls and the ceiling. The creature looked like a spider monkey, with its tail curled around its body. It moved back and forth, not smoothly but in small jolts, almost like what you see while using a flip book. I was a bit intimidated by it, but was never stricken with fear. I saw it from as young as I can remember until about age 10. After that it just stopped. My rational adult mind tells me that my imagination as a child ran wild. I tell myself that I expected to see the creature, and that's why I did so often. In the back of my head, I know what I saw. Redditor 50, when I was a kid I woke up early one morning and was really groggy. I look on the floor for some reason and I saw a little boy laying on the pillow on the floor. Freaked me out. Redditor 51, so this technically happened to me, but I was a baby and don't remember. My mom told me this once when we were talking about paranormal activity and whether she believed. She had a couple of incidents, but the one with me went thusly. Mom was at home waiting for the HVAC man to come do something, I do not recall what. My dad was at work, and she was alone with me. I wasn't more than two. The HVAC man had a reputation of being a weirdo. He was weirdly religious and very superstitious, and all the other women in the neighborhood didn't like being alone with him. My mom figured he was just misunderstood, and she said he was odd but never made her uncomfortable. Now, I was having screaming nightmares every night. No one knew why. I was in my own room, which was the first room a child had slept in, since the house was built after my sister was born. Mom didn't tell the guy any of this, so he is checking all the rooms for whatever he's there to do, and he walks into my room and stops dead. He asked my mom if I had nightmares. She said yes, and he told her that the house was built on an Indian burial ground, and we had angered the spirits. They were upset, and that was upsetting me. My mom said she didn't really know what to say, and he asked her if she wanted him to perform an exorcism. Mom told him sure wouldn't hurt, right? He went to his truck, got his Bible, and wandered around my room muttering she didn't know what, waving the Bible, that sort of thing. After a few minutes, he turned to her and said that the spirits were calmed and everything should be fine. He finished his work and went in his merry way. Mom said I didn't have another nightmare after that. She has no idea how to explain it. Redditor 52, I have two, both kinda lame, and both when feeding neighbors' cats while they were on vacation. Two different houses neighbors. First one is from left neighbor. I was going to her cat's litter box, which was through a hallway, and I felt someone grab my shoulder hard and pull me back towards them. I was almost lifted off my feet, it was so strong. My mom was rooms away. Later, we had that neighbor over for Christmas, and she told us that she thinks her mother and father's spirits are still in the house, and that they call her name sometimes. Second is neighbor to the right. I was with another neighbor friend and we were like 14-ish. I wasn't the one getting paid, but I just went for fun. The neighbor has four cats and I was with three of them. All of a sudden I heard my name. I thought it was my friend making a voice, but she said it wasn't. After she came and hung out with me on the couch. A minute later two of the cats' hair stood up straight on their backs and they ran into the bathroom and laid in the bathtub. Then I heard my name much louder. I left and when I got home I told my parents and they just kinda looked at me. Turns out when I was a baby, prob like two, before the other neighbors moved in there was an older lady who lived there and used to love to play with me. She killed herself by overdosing and falling asleep in the bathtub. I do not cats it anymore. Redditor 53, when I was younger, my mother went missing and was presumed dead even though they never found her body. My mom always made sure to kiss us goodnight no matter what time it was or if we were already asleep. So about a month after my mom disappeared, I'm sleeping on the living room floor with a friend of mine next to me and just as I'm drifting off to sleep, I feel the most realistic kiss on my cheek that I doubt was just my mind playing tricks. I truly believe it was my mom saying goodbye. Also, this happened during the first week of summer break and it was my dad's weekend to have us, so on the last day of school, as I'm walking out the door, I said goodbye to my family who was in town for my 8th grade graduation but got this very strange feeling when I looked at my mom. I had to fight back tears and had the strongest urge to go back inside but I needed to go to school, so I left. That was the last time I ever saw her. She was gone 5 days later. Redditor 54, in 2000, my wife and I had just purchased a large old Victorian style home to have room for our three kids, ages 2, 5, 7. Early one beautiful spring morning, with the sun shining bright, half asleep, I opened my eyes to see a woman in an early 1900s yellow dress with little flowers smiling down at me. She said, "Don't worry, the children will be safe here." Still mostly asleep, I thought, "Okay, good," and dozed off again for a few seconds. Then the realization hit me of what I just saw, and I sat straight up in bed fully awake. The woman in yellow wasn't there, of course. But that's not the creepy part. Fast forward to the next spring. I was teaching at the local middle school. I was in the break room with a number of people. All of them filtered out, except one older lady who was a teacher's aide at the school. She had been close friends with the previous owners of the home, another family with young kids who had moved away for job opportunities. She asked me how I liked the house. I said it was great to have room for the kids. Then she looked around to make sure we were alone, and asked, "Have you seen the woman in yellow yet?" I nearly crapped my pants on the spot, and by the look on my face she knew I had. I told her my story, and she said one of the little girls who had lived there before talked about the yellow lady keeping her from getting hurt. Redditor 55, this happened around 4 years ago, and the coincidences of everything just still seem odd. My dad worked in a job that led him to travel a lot, and so while I was at home, he would ask me to stop by over the weekends and feed the cats. My parents were divorced and I lived with my mom. The feedings weren't really needed, they always had dry food. But when I came by I gave them wet food. So my dad is going to head out on another trip and asks me to feed the cats in advance on their son. No problem. However, on that Thursday I just felt like shit and overall blay, and since the cats had dry food, I took the day off knowing they would be fine. Oddity 1. I never skipped a day before that. On Friday my mom and I went out for lunch, and she offered to swing by my dad's place so I could feed them. Oddity 2. I always went on my own. And as we're driving to his house, she starts getting stomach problems, and needs to use the bathroom in his house while I'm there. Oddity 3. She usually didn't like to go in his house. So we get there and his car is still in the garage. I didn't think anything of it, and just thought he took a cab to the airport. Oddity 5. He never did that ever. We go in and the house smells like shit. Like ungodly. Nature calls, so mom still goes to the bathroom but is almost gagging. I go to the litter box to clean it, assuming that's the source of the smell, only to see that one of my cats has brought in several dead birds. Oddity 6. When dad's not home he doesn't hunt. I refuse to clean up the birds since I'm easily grossed out, and head over to feed the cats. By this time my mom finishes and goes to wait by the door for me to finish, only to spot my dad's wallet and keys. She makes the realization that since he needs both of those, he's still here. Oddity 7. The keys and wallet were not in plain sight. So she tells me this, and so I go upstairs to see him, and I go into his room, and find him dead. He died of a heart attack on Monday. He'd been dead for a few days, and looking back now everything prior to that made sense. But the paranormal part of this is, despite how terrible the entire situation was, there were so many oddities that happened that softened the blow. Had I gone Thursday, or alone on Friday, I would have been completely alone if I even found him at all. Had my mom not gone in and seen the keys, I wouldn't have thought anything was wrong at all, since I was unused to corpse smells and I thought it was cat shit and dead birds. It was like my mom and I were being guided by some weird force that made us do things that we never really did prior, and I was a good guide since, like I said, had any of the things not happened, it would have been much more traumatic than it was. Redditor 56, I lived in a couple of weird houses when I was a kid. The first one was definitely the weirder of the two. Voices would call out when there was no one else in the house, you could hear footsteps on the stairs, and my toys moved around on their own on a couple of occasions. The other house was less weird and more eerie. Footsteps, phantom figures standing in the bedroom doorway at night, doors opening and closing on their own, and a general sense of unease. Not saying that it's ghosts or whatever, just that I can't personally explain what went on in those houses. Redditor 57, huge creature in a black shredded cape ran across a road that just me and my sister were driving on and hopped the fence to a military base. No clue what the duck it was. I just call it the devil. Redditor 58, a few years back I was messing around with my then new cell phone. I was just taking pictures of random stuff just to test out the camera. Well, I happened to take a picture of my backyard and I shit you not, in the picture was this outline of this man. He was next to my pool, looked around 6 feet 0 inches and it was defiantly not there when I was looking. I can't recall if I deleted the picture due to fear or it just didn't save. Regardless, it's freaky as can be. Redditor 59, I've told this before, and it's not super scary but it is true. I was in the living room with my grandma one day. She was doing a word search and I was browsing Reddit on my iPad. The TV was off and windows were closed. All of a sudden I hear my name being whispered right next to me. Well, my nickname, like if my name was Michael the first heard Mike. I looked up to my grandma and asked if she had called me. She says no, but I heard your name. It creeped me out for days afterwards. Redditor 60, was home one night and about to go to bed when I realized that I hadn't checked my phone to see if I had missed any calls. Was an old push button landline phone, and the easiest way to check was to push the big speaker phone button, then hear if you had messages by the pulsing dial tone. I was on the floor at the time exercising before going to bed, and as soon as the thought hit me, I glanced at the phone and the speaker phone came on by itself. Again, the only way to activate it was to push the button physically. Apparently I have telekinetic phone checking powers. I also had no messages. Also saw the Lake Champlain monster late one night while camping with a friend. I don't consider that paranormal though, since it's presumably a large physical creature.